Salamta, Taina is Tilling. Rastafari, Shalom. This is Wanda Malanzo, the Lion of Judah Society. Now, it's been required of Vindai to come up with a design, a painting or drawing that would accurately represent in its fullness the events that take place in the book of the prophet Daniel, specifically the destruction of the statue or the idol of the image. Since we've been since the time it's been required of us, as soon as we read that message, the only thing that could come to mind, and still is the only thing that it is given to us to be able to see fully and clearly, is 1963, addressed to the General Assembly of the United Nations, New York, His Imperial Majesty Haile Selassie I, his speech. The ultimate challenge speech, and you know, pretty much that since the beginning, that's what comes to mind. And you know, this is kind of like a, within the book of Daniel, there's so much, and if one's do a little bit of research, it is quite evident that of a truth, there is much information out there. I mean, there are tons and tons of interpretations and teachings and lectures concerning that topic, the visions of Daniel and the statue, the idol, and stuff like that, and that stone that becomes the head of the corner, you know, that brings an end to these vanities and stuff like that. Forgive me if we didn't even quote that directly from the book of the prophet Daniel, but you know, honestly, we took the liberty to read a little bit into it, but there is no changing what is, you know. And to be able to explain how all that information concerning the book of Daniel, even though it is accurate and true, how it has failed to have any sense of real sense of application, applicability to the betterment and improvement of this here world. To try to explain that, we will use as a reference point the basis for Western civilization education. See, in Western civilization, man is divided so intensely that man, or you know, one that has the appearance of man, begins since his birth to be taught that he must be broken and divided to such an extent that he may only become knowledgeable in the most minute and smallest of categories or subjects of study possible. For example, in Western civilization, we have individuals that study a lifetime on everything that has to do with, for example, a tooth. So one person could be receive a doctorate title, you know, honors, whatever they call it, on a certain tooth. Now, this individual most likely will spend the rest of his life, as is taught to do so in Western civilization and its miseducation, will spend the rest of his life learning everything that there can possibly be learnt concerning that tooth. Or it could, you know, I mean, it's only an example. It may not be the bestest one, but so anyways, surely a few people could ever attain knowledge of even half the things that these specialists have obtained concerning their very limited, very small area of studies. But outside of that tooth, this individual knows nothing about life whatsoever. And in some cases, this person may not even know anything about any other tooth within that same mouth. And so this division creates what we can now clearly see in the many, many teachings and so-called prophetical viewpoints and interpretations of the book of the prophet Daniel, and how they have failed to bring forth any such interpretation that is practical and applicable. You know, so YouTube it, there's hundreds of videos, Daniel's timeline, the statue, the stone that break it, the idol into pieces and stuff like that, but although truly most of the information is accurate and true, there's nothing that ones can do with that information at all. So the destruction of that idol, vanity statue, you know, useless beastly image, the way that we have been given to represent that in a vision form is it's so much that not even pictures and images can represent the fullness of this. This can only be overstood and by thus eventually practiced and perfected through the sound, the word, the power of the sound of the word being spoken by the very God himself. No, I mean, as difficult as it may seem, there is so much within the book of the prophet Daniel that this is outside of the limitations or abilities of artistic representation. This can only be fully received by the sound, by listening and hearing the voice of him that speaketh these revelations concerning the complete book of the prophet Daniel. I mean, this is too big for any artist to represent, but the mouth of the mighty God himself has spoken these words, you know, and the world has failed to receive such counsel. But we this day bring forth that which is actually true, certain, sure, and practical. That which can be applied and which will further the progress of this world, human community, for the better of all peoples. It is the word of the Almighty God himself that destroyed the vanity which was that statue, that idol, the words of his imperial majesty. Now we're going to bring forth explanation, rightful interpretation of that which was spoken of by the prophet Daniel in two parts, because first part we'll go into, and we're going to be using selected speeches of his imperial majesty. Now continuing forward, we're going to be reading from selected speeches, and we're going to be dividing this presentation in two parts. If it's not too long, it'll be the same video, but there will be two distinct sections. One will be the dream and the interpretation thereof, and how it is sure and true, and then we'll go forth into the solutions to the questions which we are confronted with in this here times. So basically, right around chapter, you know, towards the end of chapter 1 or maybe even the beginning of chapter 2, King Nebuchadnezzar calls upon the magicians and all those soothsayers and stuff like that, and he requires of them the dream and the interpretation. But you know, these people fail to even contemplate or meditate that such requirement is possible, you know. And they even go as far as saying that you know, never doth man require this of man for you know, the answers to these questions, which are outside of the limitations of man. You know, the answer to them are dwell amongst the gods, only amongst the gods whose dwelling are not amongst men, something to that effect. So basically they kind of go to the king Nebuchadnezzar and say, like, pretty much, you know, this thing that you're asking, it's impossible, no one can do it, this is something for the gods, and their dwelling is not amongst the men. And so, and for the same reason, no king hath ever required such requirement from his servants, you know. And so, but then Daniel, you know, he brings forth the dream and the interpretation that belonged to the king, that hath been given to the king. And so that'll be related to part one, and it has to do with His Imperial Majesty's Haile Selassie first address to the League of Nations, and then the second part will be the fulfillment. And you know, if we base ourselves on biblical standards, thus the speech in 1963 addressing the General Assembly of the United Nations, spoken of the Most High God Jah Rastafari himself, Haile Selassie first, that would be, if we base ourselves on biblical scripture, then that would be the authority and that would legitimize him to be a prophet. But we as Rastafari here do testify more than a prophet. But nonetheless, you know, within the book of Deuteronomy, it is said that if ones come speaking dreams and those dreams come not to pass, then surely they are false prophets. But him that declared dreams that do come to pass, be sure that he is of God, you know, of the Almighty himself. And so, I mean, even that is a clear, you know, a clear indication that His Imperial Majesty, regardless of what people wanna pretend that he's not, which is in fact and in truth and in spirit, that in itself testifies and legitimizes his status as prophet. I mean, it is what it is. So that will be within this reasoning the second part to our presentation. Now, before we go on to read some of the and we're not going to read the whole speeches, but we're going to read small portions that most likely have everything to do with this requirement that has been allotted to I, and that is to make manifest a vision that we within our community, within our family, can use to represent the destruction of the image of the idol, of the statue, in a manner of which we as Rastafari can relate, and you know, so that this work of art could be holy Rastafari spirit and truth in its fullness and stuff like that. And so going forward, we wrote down some notes concerning this here requirement. The book of the prophet Daniel, a vision painted in words, is what we titled it. For this vision, none but the mouth of the Almighty God himself can declare and represent in fullness, you know, too much for even pictures to describe. So going forward, no picture other than the event itself can describe in full what the mouth of the everlasting Father hath himself declared. You know, he that formeth the mouth, shall he not speak? He that formeth the ear, shall he not hear? You know, and so going forward, it is with these words that the image, idol, or statue mentioned in the book of the prophet Daniel hath been destroyed. In 1963, October 7th, New York, addressed to the United Nations General Assembly by the words of the mouth of God, God raised man above the animal and endowed him with reason and intelligence. That day, God raised man into the heavenly kingdom in which all man is equal and freed from the cruel and godless governance of man over man. Also, in this speech, 1963, concerning the questions to which there are no answers to, the questions of which there are no answers to and have never been asked before. Concerning this, these questions never asked before, of which the pages of history give no solution to, leads to the exalting of man and the presence of the Almighty God, creator of all, that is within him. And so this totally discredits the vain and foolish approach of the magicians and prophets and stuff like that that served King Nebuchadnezzar, which declared or supposed that these difficulties can only be resolved, that these difficulties only have solution amongst the gods of which do not dwell amongst men. His Imperial Majesty, not only does he raise man above the animal and endows him with reason and intelligence, that we may find solutions, peaceful solutions, civilized solutions to disputes and difficulties, but also establish that one must turn first to the Almighty God, trust in him, and he will not discern us or desert us, and that we must look deep within our soul, within ourselves, deep into the depth of our souls, and become something bigger than we have ever been. And so this clearly establishing the presence of God amongst I and I, you know, gods do not dwell amongst men, but the Almighty true and only God doth abide in man, you know. And so going forward, the image representing kingdoms and powers, wealth, governments, ideas, beliefs, philosophies, all have been discredited and destroyed with the voice of God as logical fallacies. An example of this would be until the philosophy, you know, it is until these requirements, the hope for lasting peace, international morality, is nothing but a fleeing illusion of which we are in pursuit, still will never attain. For it is illogical, it is a fallacy in logic, an error in reasoning, to think that one can attain such a goal, going about it in the manner of which we have been doing so for quite some time now. Through the basis of inequality, fallacy that one race is superior to another, that a nation is superior to another, that there are different classes of citizens, and so on and so forth. So we go on to make mention that Cain slew Abel with a stone tool stone tools since the beginning have caused man's own destruction. The act of becoming a weapon or forming a weapon since the beginning have been the source of man's own destruction. the stone not cut with human hands. This stone has broken in pieces the image that for long man has been deceived into reflecting. The voice of God said it. We have all heard it. And so now we go on to reference selected speeches of His Imperial Majesty. Part one is appeal to the League of Nations. And as we made mention, part two would be October 7th, 1963, New York. His Imperial Majesty addresses the United Nations General Assembly. And covenant violated. Those are the terms of the report of the Committee of 13. The Council and the Assembly unanimously adopted the conclusion that the Italian government had violated the covenant and was in a state of aggression. I did not hesitate to declare that I did not wish for war, that it was imposed upon me, and I should struggle solidly for the independence and integrity of my people, and that in that struggle I was the defender of the cause of all small states exposed to the greed of a powerful neighbor. In October 1935, the 52 nations who are listening to me today gave me an assurance that the aggressor would not triumph, that the resources of the covenant would be employed in order to ensure the reign of right and the failure of violence. I ask the 52 nations not to forget today the policy upon which they embarked 8 months ago, and on faith of which I directed the resistance of my people against the aggressor whom they had denounced to the world. Despite the inferiority of my weapons, the complete lack of aircraft, artillery, munitions, hospital services, my confidence in the League was absolute. I thought it to be impossible that 52 nations, including the most powerful in the world, should be successfully opposed by a single aggressor. Counting on the faith due to treaties, I had made no preparations for war, and that is the case with certain small countries in Europe. When the danger became more urgent, being aware of my responsibilities towards my people during the first 6 months of 1935, I tried to acquire armaments. Many governments proclaimed an embargo to prevent my doing so, whereas the Italian government, through the Suez Canal, was given all facilities for transporting without cessation and without protest troops, arms, and munitions. We'll go forward to what of promises. What have become of the promises made to me as long ago as October 1935? I noted with grief, but without surprise, that three powers considered their undertaking under the covenant as absolutely of no value. Their connections with Italy impelled them to refuse to take any measures whatsoever in order to stop Italian aggression. On the contrary, it was a profound disappointment to me to learn the attitude of a certain government which, whilst ever protesting its scrupulous attachment to the covenant, has tirelessly used all its efforts to prevent its observance. As soon as any measure which was likely to be rapidly effective was proposed, various pretexts were devised in order to postpone even consideration of the measure. Did the secret agreements of January 1935 provide for this tireless obstruction? The Ethiopian government never expected other governments to shed their soldiers' blood to defend the covenant when their own immediately personal interests were not at stake. Ethiopian warriors asked only for means to defend themselves. On many occasions, I have asked for financial assistance for the purchase of arms. That assistance has been constantly refused me. What then, in practice, is the meaning of Article 16 of the Covenant and of collective security? The Ethiopian government's use of the railway from Djibouti to Addis Ababa was in practice hampered as regards transport of arms intended for the Ethiopian forces. At the present moment, this is the chief, if not the only, means of supply of the Italian armies of occupation. The rules of neutrality should have prohibited transports intended for Italian forces, but there is not even neutrality, since Article 16 lays upon every state member of the League the duty not to remain a neutral, but to come to the aid not of the aggressor, but of the victim of aggression. Has the covenant been respected? Question mark. Is it today being respected? Question mark. Finally, a statement has just been made in their parliaments by the governments of certain powers, amongst them the most influential members of the League of Nations, that since the aggressor has succeeded in occupying a large part of Ethiopian territory, they propose not to continue the application of any economic and financial measures that may have been decided upon against the Italian government. These are the circumstances in which, at the request of the Argentine government, the Assembly of the League of Nations meets to consider the situation created by Italian aggression. I assert that the problem submitted to the Assembly today is a much wider one. It is not merely a question of the settlement of Italian aggression. League threatened. It is collective security. It is the very existence of the League of Nations. It is the confidence that each state is to place in international treaties. It is the value of promises made to small states that their integrity and their independence shall be respected and ensured. It is the principle of the equality of states on the one hand, or otherwise the obligation laid upon small powers to accept the bonds of vassalship. In a word, it is international morality that is at stake. Have the signatures appended to a treaty value only insofar as the signatory powers have a personal, direct, and immediate interest involved? Question mark. No subtlety can change the problem or shift the grounds of the discussion. It is in all sincerity that I submit these considerations to the Assembly at a time when my people are threatened with extermination, when the support of the League may ward off the final blow. May I be allowed to speak with complete frankness, without reticence, in all directness, such as is demanded by the rule of equality as between all state members of the League? Question mark. Apart from the kingdom of the Lord, there is not on this earth any nation that is superior to any other. Should it happen that a strong government finds it may with impunity destroy a weak people, then the hour strikes for that weak people to appeal to the League of Nations to give its judgment in all freedom. God and history will remember your judgment. And that concludes part one. And now we're going to go forward to part two, which is the fulfillment of the words prophesied of His Majesty. And so we go forward. His Imperial Majesty's speech to the United Nations General Assembly, October 6th, 1963. Mr. President, distinguished delegates, 27 years ago, as Emperor of Ethiopia, I mounted a rostrum in Geneva, Switzerland, to address to the League of Nations an appeal for relief from the destruction which had been unleashed against my defenseless nation by the fascist invader. I spoke then both to and for the conscience of the world. My words went unheeded, but history testifies to the accuracy of the warning that I gave in 1936. Today I stand before the world organization which has succeeded to dismantle, discarded by its discredited predecessor, and its body is enshrined the principle of collective security which is unsuccessfully invoked at Geneva. Here in this assembly reposes the best, perhaps the last hope for the peaceful survival of mankind. In 1936 I declared that it wasn't the covenant of the League that was at stake, but international morality, and the talkings I said then have little worth if the will to keep them is lacking. The Charter of the United Nations expresses the noblest aspirations of man, the application of force in the settlement of dispute between states, the assurance of human rights and fundamental freedoms for all without distinction as to race, sex, language, or religion, the safeguarding of international peace and security. But these two, as were the phrases of the covenant, are only words, that their value depends wholly on our will to observe and honor them, and give them content and meaning. The preservation of peace and governing of man's basic freedoms and rights require courage and eternal vigilance. Courage to speak and to act, and if necessary, to suffer and die. For truth and justice, eternal vigilance that the least transgression of international morality should not go undetected and unremedied. These lessons must be learned anew by each succeeding generation, and that generation is fortunate indeed which learns from other than its own bitter experience. This organization and each of its members bear a crushing and awesome responsibility to observe the wisdom of history and apply it to the problems of the present in order that future generations may be born and live and die in peace. Should we fail to achieve this goal, we should have condemned the coming generations to inherit the tragedy of our time. I have lived too long to cherish many illusions about the essential blindedness of men when brought into stark confrontation with the issue of control over their security and their property interest. Not even now, when so much is at stake, would many nations willingly entrust their destinies to other hands. Yet this is the ultimatum presented to us: secure the conditions whereby men will trust their security to a larger entity or risk annihilation. Pursue men that their salvation rest with the subordination of nation and local interest to the interest of mankind, or endanger man's future. These are the objectives, yesterday unobtainable, today essential, which we must labor to achieve. Until this is accomplished, mankind's future remains hazardous, and permanent peace a matter for speculation. I would now like to mention briefly today two particular issues: disarmament and the establishment of the true equality among man. Disarmament has become the urgent imperative of our time. I do not say this because I believe that the absence of arms is then amount to peace, or because I believe that bringing an end to the nuclear arms race automatically guarantees the peace, or because the elimination of nuclear warheads from the arsenals of the world will bring in its wake that change in attitude required for the peaceful settlements and disputes between nations. Disarmament is vital today because of the immense destructive capacity which men now possess. Ever since the Stone Age, production of arms has always been the source of man's own destruction. Even though the achievement of general and complete disarmament is time-consuming, it is encouraging to note that great efforts have been devoted to its obtainment. My country supports the nuclear test ban treaty in the atmosphere as a step towards the goal. Even though it is only a partial step, the real significance of a treaty is it admits of a placid statement between the nations which initiated it. A stalemate which recognizes the blunt, unavoidable fact that none would emerge from the total destruction which would be the lot of all in a nuclear war. A statement which affords us and the United Nations a breathing spell in which to act. The goal of the equality of man which we seek is the very antithesis of the exploitation of one people by another, about which the pages of history, and particularly those written about the African and Asian continents, speak at such length. Last May at Addis Ababa, there was convened a meeting of heads of African states and government. In 3 days, the 32 nations who presented at this conference demonstrated to the world that when the will and determination exist, nations and peoples of various backgrounds can and will work together in unity towards the achievements of common goals, in the assurance and that equality and brotherhood which we desire. Although our position is of either power bloc is identified with the policy of non-alignment, our past history testifies to the fact that we have always endeavored to cooperate with all nations without exception. Thus, one of the fundamental principles we have agreed upon at the Addis Ababa Summit Conference gives expression to our fundamental desire to live in harmony and cooperation with all states. on the question of racial discrimination, the Addis Ababa conference taught to those who will learn this future lesson, this further lesson, that until the philosophy that holds one race superior and another inferior is finally and permanently discredited and abandoned, until there are no longer first-class and second-class citizens of any nation, that until the color of a man's skin is of no more significance than is the color of his eyes, that until the basic human rights and equality guaranteed to all without regards to race, that until that day, the dream of lasting peace, world citizenship, and the rule of international morality would remain but a fleeting illusion to be pursued but never attained. And until the ignoble and unhappy regimes that hold our brothers in Angola and Mozambique and South Africa in sub-human bondage have been toppled and destroyed, until bigotry and prejudice, malicious and inhumane self-interest have been replaced by understanding, tolerance, and goodwill, until all Africans stand up and speak as free human beings, equal in the eyes of all men as they are in the eyes of heaven, until that day the African continent will not know peace. We Africans will fight if necessary, and we know that we shall win, as we are confident in the victory of good over evil. The basis of racial discrimination, colonialism, has been economic, and it is with economic weapons that these evils have been and can be overcome in pursuance of resolutions adopted at the Addis Ababa Summit Conference. African states have undertaken certain measures in the economic field, which, if adopted by all member states in the United Nations, would soon reduce intransitors to reason. I ask today for adherence to these measures by every man, every nation represented here, which is truly devoted to the principles enshrined in the Charter. I do not believe that Portugal or South Africa are prepared to commit economic or physical suicide. If honorable and reasonable alternatives exist, I believe that such alternatives can be found. We must act while we can, while the occasion exists, to exert those legitimate pressures available to us, lest time run out and result be had to less happy means. The great nations of the world would do well to remember that in this modern age, even their own faith is not wholly in their hands. Peace requires the united efforts of us all. Who can foresee what spark might ignite the fuse? The stakes are all identical for all of us, life or death. We all wish to live. We all seek a world in which men are freed of the burdens of ignorance, poverty, hunger, and disease. That we should all be hard-pressed to escape the deadly rain of nuclear fallout should catastrophe overtake us. The problems which confront us today are unprecedented. They have no counterpart in human experience. Man searches through the pages of history for solutions for precedents, but at last there are none to be found. This then is the ultimate challenge. Where are we to look for our survival, for answers to questions which have never been asked? We must look first to the Almighty God, who has raised man above the animals and endowed him with intelligence and reason. We must put our faith in him, and he will not desert us or permit us to destroy mankind in which he has created in his image. We must look to ourselves, into the depths of our souls. We must become something we have never been, for which our education and experience and environment have ill prepared us. We must become bigger than we have ever been, more courageous, greater in spirit, ampler in our crook. We must become members of a new race, overcoming petty prejudice, owing our ultimate allegiance not to the nations but to our fellow men within the human community. October 7th, 1963, New York, address to the United Nations General Assembly. Germawik edamawi khayle selasi so yom exaber moambesa zem negede yehuda negusi negesht ze Ethiopia. Rastafari, shalom.